for those who are taught to hate their queerness, for those who still have to hide to be safe. If you still haven't said it out loud, if you already know your beauty, the spirit of abiding love is proud of you. Your gathered community is proud of you. Any belonging that depends on your hiding is not belonging, it's bondage. Be patient with yourself, but know that you deserve this. Who is unafraid of the whole of you? Who will remind you of your dignity? You are made of glory. The spirit within us all uplifts you with pride. Release the lie of shame. You are worthy. You are safe. You are sacred.
Good morning, all. My name is Matthew Shinneman, and I am the Director of Lifespan Faith Development here at UUCY, and it's a pleasure to be with you this morning. Now, you know, there are many ways that change can be affected. There is through the way of prophetic voices, when you publicly stand up and speak out against things that you perceive to be wrong or unjust. There are parallel voices where you advocate for an alternative structure, a new system to replace the old one. And then there are institutional voices, which seek to work within the established power structures to change them from within. Now, I want you to think for a moment. Have you ever stopped to think about all the people that you love? All the different people who love you? There are many kinds of love and many ways to show that you love someone. Now, what's a holiday that we normally associate with love? Valentine's Day. Absolutely. And we often give people Valentine's Day cards, right? And receiving a card can make someone feel special and appreciated, especially if it is a homemade Valentine, or my kids' personal favorites when they have puns. So think about all the people that you have ever sent a Valentine's Day card to. Your parents, maybe your grandparents. What about your cousins or your friends? Maybe your neighbors? Raise those hands nice and high if you've ever sent a Valentine's Day card. Now keep them raised if you've ever sent one to your state governor. Now you see, that's exactly what a bunch of Unitarian Universalists did back in 2005. In the state of California, it was still illegal for two men or two women to marry. And UUs all over the state, following our principles, love, justice, compassion, equity, using the democratic process, they all got together and they sent Arnold Schwarzenegger 3,800 Valentines. We value love, and if a law says that your love is not equal to my love, we will stand up against it. This is institutional voices speaking out. So in the days leading up, people in almost every youth congregation in California, they got together, they had coffee hours where congregants, members, friends, old and young would sit and they would make Valentine's Day cards. Some would even have glitter. And those who work with children know how annoying glitter can be sometimes, but also how beautiful it can be. So they glued ribbon and lace. They wrote messages of love and acceptance and justice, because that's what it means to be a Unitarian Universalist. Not just to say it, but to do something about it. And working together for that justice created joy and hope. Now, later that year, Governor Schwarzenegger did have an opportunity to support same-sex marriage, and he did not. It would take another 3 years until the state of California legalized the right of two men or two women to marry. But don't let that discourage you, because that action led to Unitarian Universalists being known as one of the leaders in the campaign for marriage equality in the United States. The children and adults who made those Valentines showed everyone how our congregations can band together and to work for justice. And even though the number of Unitarian Universalists in California are small compared to those of other religions, which is probably the same that can be said about here in Pennsylvania, some of those UUs were invited to a meeting with the governor to explain their views. They became leaders of groups of multiple religions to lead marriage equality to the courts. And it was all because of those Valentines. Now, as Unitarian Universalists, we strive for justice, equity, and compassion. You can do it in many ways. As I said, there are prophetic voices. The Pride Festival yesterday, and all around the country. Pride marches and parades. Those are prophetic ways of getting your voice out and saying, this is the way it should be. There are parallel voices creating new structures because the current structures are awful. And there are institutional voices knowing that, yes, this system is messed up, but There are ways to work at it within. Choose yours wisely, but choose. Choose you must. Blessed be and amen.
Today's reading is an excerpt from Audre Lorde's essay, The Transformation of Silence into Language and Action. Audre Lorde described herself as a Black, lesbian, mother, warrior, and poet, and dedicated both her life and her creative talent to confronting and addressing injustices of racism, sexism, classism, and homophobia. Each of us is here now because in one way or another, we share a commitment to language and to the power of language and to the reclaiming of that language which has been made to work against us. In the transformation of silence into language and action, it is vitally necessary for each of us to establish or examine her functions in that transformation and to recognize her role as vital within that transformation. For those of us who write, it is necessary to scrutinize not only the truth of what we speak, but the truth of that language by which we speak it. For others, it is to share and spread also those words that are meaningful to us. But primarily for us all, it is necessary to teach by living and speaking those truths which we believe and know beyond our understanding. Because in this way alone can we survive, by taking part in a process of life that is creative and continuing. That is growth. And it is never without fear of visibility, of the harsh light of scrutiny, and perhaps judgment, of pain, of death. But we have lived through all of those already, in silence, except death. And I remind myself all the time now that if I were to have been born mute or had maintained an oath of silence my whole life long for safety, I would still have suffered and I would still die. It is very good for establishing perspective. And where the words of women are crying to be heard, we must each of us recognize our responsibility to seek those words out, to read them and share them and examine them in their pertinence to our lives, that we may not hide behind the mockeries of separations that have been imposed upon us and which we so often accept as our own. For instance, I can't possibly teach Black women's writing. Their experience is different from mine. Yet how many years have you spent teaching Plato and Shakespeare and Proust? Or another, she is a white woman, and what could she possibly have to say to me? Or, she is a lesbian, what would my husband say? Or my chairman? Or again, this woman writes of her sons, and I have no children, and all the other endless ways in which we rob ourselves of ourselves and each other. We can learn to work and speak when we are afraid in the same way we have learned to work and speak when we are tired. For we have been socialized to respect fear more than our own needs for language and definition. And while we wait in silence for that final luxury of fearlessness, the weight of that silence will choke us. The fact that we are here and that I speak these words is an attempt to break that silence and bridge some of those differences between us. For it is not difference which immobilizes us, but silence. And there are so many silences to be broken. Thank you.
but primarily for us all. It is necessary to teach by living and speaking those truths which we believe and know beyond understanding. Because in this way alone can we survive, by taking part in a process of life that is creative and continuing, that is growth. There is no one singular capital T truth that it can express the entirety of human experience, especially those that we know beyond understanding. These words by Audre Lorde from her essay, The Transformation of Silence into Language and Action, that Shannon shared with us, resonate deeply with me. This morning, we chose to celebrate Pride within our faith community. Pride had its origins in the Stonewall Uprising of June of 1969, when police conducted a raid on the mafia-run Stonewall Inn in Greenwich Village that led to arrests and subsequent violence. These raids were routine at the time, and laws at the time not only declared homosexuality a crime, but even the wearing of, quote, fewer than three items of clothing that matched the person's sex, unquote. One of the first people arrested, a lesbian wearing masculine clothing, as described, shouted to people nearby to do something. And Marsha P. Johnson and Sylvia Rivera, both trans women of color, were among the first to answer that call. First, silence was transformed into language, and then it was transformed into action. By living and speaking their own truths, they were able to survive and to make it possible for more people to survive by naming their own truths. Truth they believed and knew beyond understanding. The truth of who they were. The truth of who they loved. The truth of how they wanted to live in the world, free and unafraid. In 2022, 53 years after the Stonewall Uprising, we are right to note how much progress has been made. And we must also note that there is work happening that can undo that progress. In 1969 in New York, with the three items of clothing not matching one's sex law, police officers raiding the Stonewall Inn or any one of a number of similar establishments would take patrons into restrooms to strip search them to verify their sex. This sexual abuse under the guise of authority is abhorrent. And yet, in 2022, there is a continued proliferation of so-called bathroom bills affecting transgender youth. This is primarily in schools, but any person who is transgender in a space where these laws and rules are trying to be enacted. Legislation such as Florida's Don't Say Gay bill and similar legislation about to be proposed here in Pennsylvania, as reported in Friday's Pittsburgh Post-Gazette and other places. They seem to want to reverse the process, to restrain the action of anyone who is not cisgender or heterosexual, to even regulate their language, which is to say, to regulate a true and a beautiful part of human nature back into silence. Why talk about this in a UU worship service? Because in this way alone can we survive, by taking part in a process of life that is creative and continuing, that is growth. That's why. Audre Lorde might not have thought of her writing as sacred when she was writing it, but in time, as we join together on our own spiritual journeys and choose to give our attention to that which is of highest worth, those words are sacred indeed. They are sacred to me, And by presenting them this morning, I am inviting you into this same sacred reading. Unitarian Universalism is a faith where we want to do more than welcome LGBTQIA+ siblings and selves. We strive to do more than to affirm members of this beloved community. We ideally should do nothing less than to celebrate the sacred lives, loves, and bodies that all of us possess and inhabit. This is why we affirm the inherent worth and dignity of all. This is why we affirm justice, equity, and compassion for all. This is why we offer our whole lives, OWL, a comprehensive lifespan curriculum in human relational and sexual health and liberation. I'd like to return again to our reading. This paper by Audre Lorde was originally delivered at the Modern Language Association's Lesbian and Literature panel in December of 1977. And this time I'd like to draw your attention back to these words. And all the other endless ways in which we rob ourselves of ourselves and each other. We can learn to work and speak when we are afraid in the same way we have learned to work and speak when we are tired. For we have been socialized to respect fear more than our own needs for language and definition. And while we wait in silence for that final luxury of fearlessness, the weight of that silence will choke us. The fact that we are here and that I speak these words is an attempt to break that silence and bridge some of those differences between us. For it is not difference which immobilizes us, but silence. And there are so many silences to be broken. And that's a line I've been sitting with a lot this week, this specific line. While we wait in silence for that final luxury of fearlessness, the weight of that silence will choke us. This feels applicable to many different things in our society just now, even as it is still so relevant for the work of LGBTQIA+ celebration and liberation. As Fannie Lou Hamer said, nobody's free until everybody's free. And we probably never get to liberation if we wait for that final luxury of fearlessness. And the silence that immobilizes us can be broken. It has been broken. It has. That silence has been transformed already into language and action, from Stonewall to the letter writing, Valentine writing campaign that Matt told us about. We've already done this work of transformation. There are going to be people who want to reverse that work. There will be people who want to trade in fear because that's all they know. It's hard to counter fear. It's hard to love when it comes, to love it when it comes, to love and say to our own fear, let's be companions a while because we have hard things to do. And I think I'm going to be seeing more of you. Pride began because loving people, frightened people, angry people, people longing for freedom, had the courage to transform their silence into language and their language into action. There's a phrase sometimes used in social justice movements, rest, renew, return. That's why we do this work in our faith communities. We share our fears and our joys. We rest in the knowledge that we do not struggle alone. We are renewed, and doing so, we may return. Happy Pride to each of you LGBTQIA plus siblings and selves and beloved allies. There may be times when the world feels like it's not ready to celebrate you. Deep within yourself, place sacred words as touchstones, like the ones from our chalice lighting today. You are worthy. You are safe. You are sacred. You're beautiful. You are glorious. You are whole.
In extinguishing our chalice and your home chalices, if you have lit them, with these words. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again.
Answering the call, first.
For benediction today, I have the text of the Stardust blessing that you heard mentioned during Matters of the Heart that we gave out to many, many, many people, myself and a number of our volunteers. Fortunately, in our tradition, anyone can bless, which means I don't have to do it literally all of the time. It's wonderful. And we had, I want to give a shout out, even though she's not here. Mary Beth Callow is a new member. Her husband Don is here with us today. Brought this particular blessing from a congregation that her daughter attends. And so afterwards, Shannon and I are going to be out front. If you want some glitter, we still have some glitter. It's biodegradable. And as I warned everyone yesterday, that does not mean it's still going to be in your carpet 6 months from now, but it does mean it's not adding to the plastic island floating in the Pacific, right? And as a person who received a blessing yesterday said, oh, I put this on cupcakes in my catering business. It is also edible. So if you accidentally eat some glitter, you're going to be okay. So we'll be out front with some biodegradable glitter. And if there's huge lines, we are officially saying these words over all of you right now. So please feel blessed whether you decide to get anointed with glitter or not. You are made of stardust, born of the infinite love of the universe. You are whole, holy, and good. We rejoice and give thanks that you are shining your light in this world. So good. Okay, the stuff's over here. I'm gonna give you a
Thank you.